Hello. Okay, so let us start this session. I'm sorry I got little delayed, stuck up because of this network and computer issues. So what we are going to see today is exactly the point where I left you yesterday was we have seen some very basics of quality of service, that is QoS. And we had seen what are the design challenges of QoS and what are the features of QoS. And these were the first three topics which were covered yesterday, that is real-time traffic support for QoS. We had seen one topology diagram and how the best path for depending on what is our requirement was chosen. So we had seen a topology, there were some 5-6 different criteria. We had applied five, six different paths we had been getting from that. Based on minimum delay, we had chosen one path. Based on minimum hop count, we had chosen one path. And based on best bandwidth, we had chosen one path. So routing actually depends on what is the demand and what is the quality of service expected. Based on that, the routing things are selected. So yesterday's discussion was quite easy because we were the initial part of it. So toward the end of yesterday's lecture, we had found what are the different types of classifications. So classifications were having mainly two, three different types. So one of the types were QoS classification based on layer-based solution. So MAC layer is providing some QoS-based solution. Network layer is providing some QoS-based solution. Then application layer might provide some QoS-based solution. QoS is quality of service. So today we will start, or today we will see what are the layer-based solution for QoS. And first we will see what is the MAC layer-based solution of QoS. So whenever we talk about MAC layer, that means one channel, all the nodes are accessing one channel and trying to get information through that channel. And there is always a contention. There is a CSMA, there is a carrier sensing, and if the channel is found free, then the data transmission will happen. If the channel is found not free, the channel is busy, then there is a back off timing. That is, the node, sending node, will stay back or hold its information sending for certain time, which is called as back off. So there are different types of MAC layer solution. So we'll see DCF, PCF, those explanation, and there is a frame structure for DCF and PCF. We will see that. So there is a MAC layer based solution for QoS, can be asked for a 10 marks question. Then under network based solution, there are some 3-4 different types of protocols that we will see. Out of that, first we will see ticket based QoS routing protocol. So these are the three topics for today. First we will see MAC layer based solution. Then we will see what is network based solution for QoS routing. And under network based solution, there are 3-4 different protocols. One protocol we will see today, that is ticket based QoS routing. So we are already late, so I will take this whole hour, so I'll leave you at 3 o'clock as usual. So let us start with what is meant by the MAC layer based solution for QoS. And all the things we have known so far, again I am going to repeat, because the whole first chapter was about MAC layer. Now in this slide also I have talked the same thing, so let us just go through what all are written. And this is all theoretical things, so line by line we have to read. I have taken it all from the book of Manoj and Shivram Murthy. So these are the writings that is there in the book. You can read it from my slides, and you can write 10 marks question can be written from whatever material is provided in the slides. So it says that what is the MAC layer level solution of QoS. So whenever I said QoS, there are three things we have to keep in mind. Quality of service means first the data, whatever is transmitted, should reach to the receiver within minimum period of time or within a finite time window. Second thing, whatever the number of packets transmitted, that must reach to the receiver. So number of packet transmitted should be equal to number of packets received. And third thing, whatever is the content of the packet, that should be unaltered. That means whatever are the signals transmitted, that should reach to the receiver without any kind of distortion. So these three things are maintained, means we are offering quality of service. Then from a network point of view. So this was from packet point of view. If from network point of view, if you are talking about what are the quality of services, so network should be congestion free. That is the first thing. That is a quality of service you can talk about network. Second thing, whenever there is a breakage in the link due to mobility or something, the whole network should be able to rejoin that link as soon as possible. That is also a quality of service. So rejoining the link is one quality, and rejoining the link as soon as possible, that is another quality. So quality of service actually differs from data packet point of view. One set of quality of service is there. From network connectivity point of view, one set of quality of service is there. So that you have to understand. Okay, so MAC protocol decides which node to transmit next on the broadcast channel when several nodes are contending or competing for transmission on the channel. So MAC has to decide which is the best node for data transmission. And there are certain criteria for that, that the node which is having best quality information, the node that is having most important information in the network, the node which is having a huge amount of data stored in it and all data is very important, the node which is having high energy, so battery of that node is full, and the node is able to transmit huge amount of data over short bandwidth. So these are the some criteria based on which MAC protocol selects which node will be allowed the access of the channel. So there is a competition, or there is a fighting or contention. All sender nodes are trying to get catch hold of the channel. But MAC has to allow one among all those nodes who will be given the contention of the channel. So MAC protocols for ad hoc wireless network use channel sensing. So carrier sensing, we have seen if there is any carrier present in the channel, that is called as channel sensing or carrier sensing. And random backoff schemes. What is meant by backoff? Whenever a sender wants to send some data over the channel, first it senses if there is already existing carrier on that channel or not. If there is no existing carrier on that channel, that means the channel is free. In that case, the sender will transmit data over the channel. But in case the channel is busy, carrier is sensed in that channel, what the node will do? The sender node will back off. That means it will not transmit data for a certain time. That is called as back off time, making them suitable for best effort data traffic. So whenever MAC protocol uses channel sensing and random back off, just to avoid collision, already there is data on the channel. In that case, the channel is sensed, and if there is already existing carrier on the channel, the new sender will back off. It will not transmit data over a busy channel, just to avoid congestion and collision. Real-time traffic such as voice and video requires bandwidth guarantee. So voice and video are real-time data traffic. They want a guarantee from that channel, that is a kind of a contention with some kind of reservation. So we have seen contention with reservation. There are two types: contention with time reservation, contention with bandwidth reservation. So real-time data traffic such as voice and video traffic, they ask a reservation kind of mechanism so that there is no drop of packet, there is no distortion in the information. It supports a real-time data traffic in these networks is a very challenging task. So ad hoc network with real-time data traffic is a very challenging task, because whenever I'm talking about ad hoc network, there is a mobility. Mobility breaks the link. As soon as the links are broken, the real-time data traffic will be lost. Some data packets will be lost. And in that case, continuity of the received data will be lost. Okay, so whatever data we receive at the receiver side, real-time data, that will be with distortion. So these things are avoided. So ad hoc with real time is a very difficult job to maintain. So in most of the cases, ad hoc wireless networks share a common radio channel operating in the ISM band 2 or in military band. So just write down this thing, because these questions might be asked for your quiz in IA 2. So what is the band over which ad hoc wireless network act? So ad hoc wireless networks share common radio channel operating in the ISM band 2. Just check what is the frequency, and in military bands. Most widely deployed medium access technology is IEEE 802.11 standard. So this is the Ethernet standard. It describes how a situation present in WLAN, that is wireless LAN, should access the broadcast channel for transmitting data to the other station. So if a channel wants to transmit data to the other station, how the data is transmitted? That is actually guided by the protocol IEEE 802.11 standard, which is a WLAN standard. So there are two modes of operation in IEEE 802.11 as given by, one is called as DCF, distributed coordination function, another is called as PCF or point coordination function. So whenever MAC layer solution for QoS is asked, you have to elaborate DCF and PCF. Now let us find out what are the differences. So there are two questions. One is MAC layer solution for QoS can be a 10 mark question. Second is, so you write down all this. So that is one question. Second question can be differences between distributed coordination function DCF and point coordination function PCF. So it can be asked for 5 marks. So 6 to 7 points you have to write in case of differences between DCF and PCF. So next, whatever discussion goes on there, you will find differences between DCF and PCF. DCF mode provides best effort service. That means under every kind of distortion also, DCF will try to give you best transmission. While the PCF mode is designed to provide real-time traffic support in infrastructure-based wireless network. So DCF is best suited for ad hoc wireless network, whereas PCF is actually an infrastructure-based wireless network. Ad hoc wireless network, DCF for infrastructure less wireless network, and PCF or point coordination function is for real-time traffic support, that means voice traffic in infrastructure based wireless network configuration. So what is the difference? Infrastructure based is your mobile phone network or cellular network. Infrastructure less network is nothing but ad hoc wireless network. So PCF is not much suitable over ad hoc wireless network. So due to lack of fixed infrastructure support, PCF mode of operation is not used with ad hoc wireless network. So this is a very important paragraph, that where DCF is applied. So DCF, distributed function coordination function, is used for ad hoc network, and PCF, that is point coordination function, is used for generally infrastructure based or central access point based or base station based network. IEEE 802.11 task group TGE, okay, is enhancing the legacy 802.11 standard to support the real-time traffic. So the 802.11e standard, so remember all the standards because you are communication engineers. So this standard has two other modes of operation, namely enhanced DCF. So this is DCF mode of operation. There is another enhanced DCF mode of operation and hybrid coordination function. So previously we were talking about DCF mode of operation for ad hoc wireless, PCF mode of operation for infrastructure based wireless network. Third is enhanced DCF and fourth is hybrid coordination function. So these are all MAC layer solutions to support QoS in both infrastructure based and infrastructure less situations. But as far as the syllabus is concerned, we will see only DCF and PCF. So DCF mode does not use centralized control, whereas PCF mode requires a centralized access point or CAP. All implementation of 802.11 standards for WLAN must provide the DCF mode operation. So for ad hoc wireless network, DCF is more suitable. PCF mode operation is optional. So DCF is always there for ad hoc network. Sometimes if the network is very stable, it is not having much mobility, at that time we can dare to add PCF kind of modality to this ad hoc wireless network. So PCF is an optional thing for ad hoc wireless network, but DCF is the continuously running style of MAC operation in case of ad hoc wireless network. The time interval between two transmissions, there are actually it is called inter-frame space. So one transmission has occurred from the sender to the receiver, and then there comes inter-frame space, which is given by IFS, and then there starts another transmission frame, and there are different IFS inside this MAC layer solution. So between data transmission, there are different types of time gap. What are they? So there are four IFS defined in 802.11 standard, namely short IFS. So this is another short questions which can be asked. What are the different types of inter-frame space in case of MAC protocol of QoS? So first is interference space, very short. So this is shortest time IFS, this is called short IFS. Then PCF IFS. So PCF is point coordination function IFS, this is called PIFS. Then DCF IFS, that is distributed coordination function IFS, which is called as DIFS. Extended IFS or EIFS. And what we are finding is SIFS duration is smallest. So these are SIFS, PIFS, DIFS and EIFS. They are actually the time gap between two transmission frames. And in that case, SIFS duration is smallest. Little bit more is point interframe space. Little bit more is distribution coordination function in interframe space. And highest is extended IFS. So which is greater and which is smaller, that you have to understand. SIFS is smallest duration and EIFS is highest duration between two frames that is transmitted over the channel by a sender. So with all this basic knowledge, let us understand what is meant by distributed coordination function. And all this actually we have seen previously. Just go through it. In DCF mode, all stations are allowed to contend for share medium simultaneously. So while teaching MAC, I told you that as soon as all the sender nodes are having data, they have to fight out for the access of the channel, and that actually is in a DCF mode. So when the communication is in DCF mode, when the MAC control is in DCF mode, at that time first there happens contention. CSMS CA, that is carrier sends multiple access with collision avoidance. In short, we call it CSMA. So first it is checked if there is carrier present on channel. If carrier is present, the sender goes back. It is called back of time. If the carrier is not present on the channel, then only the sender will transmit. So this CSMS CA mechanism and random back of scheme, they are used to reduce the frame collisions. So this is actually the characteristic of DCF or distributed coordination function. We have known it all, only we are giving it a name here. So what all you know, the properties of MAC. Okay, so all those properties are actually falling under the DCF function. Okay. So first, carrier sends multiple access is done. If channel is free, transmission happens. If channel is not free, random back off happens. And that back off time, I told you, back off time keep on becoming double. So first it tries to transmit data. It is finding that channel is busy. It waits for a random time, let's say 2 seconds. Then again, after 2 seconds, it tries to send data. Again, it finds channel is busy. Then again, it backs off. And how much time? 2 becomes 4 now. Okay, so this back off time becomes double. Then again, it tries to send data after 4 seconds. If it finds channel is further busy, it waits for 8 seconds. So likewise, the contention time, the back off time keeps on becoming double. So that was a problem in case of MACA protocol that we have seen. Each unicast frame, unicast means one sender, one receiver, is acknowledged immediately after being received. So whenever there is a receiver is receiving the data, it has to send the acknowledgement. If the acknowledgement is not received within a timeout period, so if the transmitter is not receiving the acknowledgement signal from the receiver, then the data frame is retransmitted. So all this we have discussed previously. Broadcast frame do not require acknowledgement. So what is broadcast? It is like it is happening now. Only I am talking and you are listening. This is broadcast. I am not expecting any kind of acknowledgement from you. Whether you are really listening, whether you are really understanding, I am not checking. Okay, so that is called actually broadcast. It is unidirectional. So that is what they are saying. Broadcast frame do not require acknowledgement from the receiver station. If station A wants to transmit data to station B, station A listens to the channel means checks for carrier presence. If the channel is busy, it waits until the channel becomes idle, channel becomes free. After detecting the idle channel, channel A further waits for a DIFS period. So immediately the channel is free, the sender does not send a data. First it checks for some time. If the channel is free, yes, channel is free. After that, the channel waits for a DIFS period of time, because this is DCF and DCF is having the interframe time called as DCF IFS, that is the DIFS. So DIFS period of time, which is quite a large time compared to SIFS. Okay. And after that also, if the channel is not free, it actually goes into hiding, or it goes into non-sending mode for a certain back of time. Okay. How the back of time is calculated is given by random 0 CW into slot time. What is there in slot time? Slot time includes time needed for a station to detect a frame. So there are 3 or 4 components in slot time. What is meant by slot time? The slot time is deciding how much is the back of time. Okay. Slot time includes the time needed for detection of a frame. That means there is a data to be transmitted and I have a node has detected it. So some time taken for that. That is called as a detection of a frame. Propagation delay. Okay, so when the frame is transmitted and it is received, that is called propagation delay. The time needed to switch from the receiving state to the transmitting state. That means one node previously was receiving, suddenly it is acting as a transmission, so there is a switchover time. And the time to signal to the MAC layer the state of the channel. So all these 4 times together is called as a slot time. And more is the propagation time, more will be the slot time. More is the time needed to detect a frame. More will be the slot time. The slot time is actually having 4 components. First is frame detection time, propagation time, switching time from receiving state to transmission state, and the time to signal the MAC the state of the channel. So these are the 4 components which is there in slot time. And more is the slot time, more is the busy period of the channel, the back of time will be more. That means the sender will be receiving for higher time to transmit the data. So the RAND function 0CW returns a pseudo random integer for a uniform distribution over an interval. So CW, slot time, RAND, back of time, it is nothing but a time for which the sender waits before transmission. When the sender finds that the channel is busy. If the channel is not busy, it waits for DIFS period of time. Till then, again, if the carrier sense is happening, and again after DIFS time, if carrier sense done and it is finding the channel is free, data transmission will occur. So this year process continues. In the case of collision, so whenever there was no collision, Aram said data transfer is going on, so no problem. But if there is a collision at the time, CW time is doubled. I told you that if it is finding that channel is busy, carrier is present on the channel, it will double its back of time. So CW is directly proportional to the back of time. As number of collision increases, CW keeps on increasing exponentially. It will reduce the probability of collision. That is, the sender is not sending any data because its back of time is increasing. If the sender is not sending any data, there will not be any collision. So CW keeps on increasing, back of time keep on increasing, collision is avoided. This is actually called as CSMS CA. After detecting the channel as idle for a DIFS period, so after carrier sense, if it is found that channel is idle, then for DIFS period, again the sender is waiting. And after DIFS period, if station A starts finding the back of time, so back of time keeps on reducing now. When the channel starts transmitting data over a free channel, then the back of time starts decreasing. If it senses the channel is busy during the countdown process, it suspends the back of counter and again it detects the channel being DIFS period. So all these things are written here, you can go through. We have seen all these things previously, only I have put in a categorically fashion. So after it is finding the channel is free, immediately it does not transmit the data. At that time RTS-CTS exchange happens, and after that data transmission takes place. So in the above scenario, that is in the DCF case, if another station C apart from A, so this is actually a hidden terminal. So if there is a hidden terminal, senses that channel is being idle and transmits the RTS frame, collision occurs, both the stations went into that. So if there is a hidden terminal C and if there is an actual terminal, sending terminal A, and they both are trying to send data to the receiver B. So this is the hidden terminal problem we have seen. That is, A and C are the transmitters. They both are trying to contend for receiver B. So in this case, their data actually collides, and the both the RTS frames, so A sends the RTS to B, C sends the RTS to B. In that case, both their RTS collides and both the sender goes into back off state. That is, both the senders go into non-transmitting state. So these are some of the critical cases that is happening. Somebody wants to read about MSDU, MPDUs, you can read here below. Okay, I'm going for what is called as PCF. That is a point coordination function. So initially I told you that whatever MAC protocol we have seen so far in the first chapter as well as here, that is actually of DCF type. That is distributed coordination function. What is point coordination function? It is actually incorporates optimal access method and have priority access to wireless media. That means one sender node is given high priority for data transmission. This access method uses two things. So remember these two things. One is called as point coordinator. What is PC? And another is called as access point. So access point is nothing but base station. And point coordinator is a specific function that is performed by some nodes inside the PCF. Okay, type of MAC. Hence, PCF is usable only in infrastructure based network configuration. So whenever there is a central coordinating unit or central access point, then we can apply PCF. A station which requires the PCF mode of operation sends an association message which is called as AID. So I told you that not every node inside ad hoc wireless network uses PCF. Very specific node, if it wants to highlight its operation, if it wants extra attention, if it wants to acquire the channel, okay, specially in that case, PCF kind of mode is activated. And the node, a station which requires a PCF mode of operation, it has to send a special indication to the base station, which is called as Association Identifier AID. The PC pole station registers its polling. So there is a centralized base station which takes all these requests from all the nodes which are sending the association identifier. So there are many nodes and there is only one base station. Whichever node wants to have a special feature of operation called as PCF, it has to send its request to the base station. Such request can come from two, three different nodes. So the base station or the centralized access point, it registers all the requests and then it keeps on checking that which node should be given the PCF request and other two nodes will not be given PCF request. The role of the PC is to overcome which station should gain the access of the channel. So point coordinate actually decides if there are three, four different nodes who are acting or who are asking for PCF mode of operation, among them which one sender will be given the contention of the channel. That is actually decided by the PC. So very important thing, the role of PC or point coordinator is to determine which station. So there are four stations who are asking for PCF mode of operation, special mode of operation. Which node should be given PCF mode of operation is decided by the point coordinator or PC. Stations requesting the PCF mode of operation get associated with PC during the contention period. So here the node which gets the PCF access, he has to transmit the data to the access point through the point coordinator PC. So that is what said, the stations requesting the PCF mode of operation get associated with the PC during the contention period. Now here, this frame structure you have to draw. If DCF and PCF both are asked, this frame structure you have to draw. So what is the frame structure? So this is one super frame. So there are two super frames actually showing. You have to draw both. Okay, and what are the signals? Just check. And ekdam first, okay, so this is a super frame. Initially it is having PCF period and then it is having DCF period. So during the PCF period, the contention happens and initial part. So with PCF, the channel access alternates between contention free period and contention period. Just check here, this is contention free period. That means there is no contention. That means all channels are trying to get equal share of the channel and this is called contention period. So contention period happens in case of DCF. So one, every channel fights for the channel here, but during PCF it is called as contention free period. Okay, so between contention free period and contention period in for the PCF and DCF mode operation respectively, a CFP, that is contention free period, following CP from a super frame. So initially PCF is related to contention free, DCF is related to contention period. Together they are forming a super frame and there are few initial signals. What is that? PC generates a beacon frame. Okay, so this TBTT, this is actually called as target beacon transmission time. So this is the starting time of the super frame. That is what is indicated by the TBTT. So TBTT was given the beacon frame. Each super frame starts with the beacon frame. So TBTT is actually a beacon frame or starting point of the overall transmission. So data transmission actually happens this way, okay, which is used to maintain a synchronization. So TBTT is actually used for keeping synchronization between all the frames. So such many super frames will keep on coming one after another. So one frame ends and then TBTT, then stretching of CP, and then beacon frame. So this is the beacon frame initially, and beacon frame starts with the sync of TBTT. So deliver the protocol related. So PC uses contention free protocol. So all those things you can just check. This is, there is a PIFS waiting time. Okay, that is point coordination function waiting time. So first there comes TBTT, then the beacon ends, then there starts PCF, then there starts ECF and DCF ends, and then again TBTT, then again beacon frame, and it keeps goes on. So if this question is asked for 5 to 8 marks, you have to explain what is DCF, what is PCF, and this frame structure. Lastly, then check, CFP may shrink due to stretching when the DCF takes more time than expected. So this DCF certain time might take more time than expected. So what is there in DCF? DCF is actually the data transmission over MAC protocol by a single channel which has won the contention. So in that case, if the channel is having many data, so certain time what happens, the CP period is extended. In that case, there is a shrinking of CFP. In that case, stretching when DCF takes more than time expected. This happens when MSDU is fragmented into several MPDUs. So certain times the whole frame has to be chopped or it has to be fragmented because data may be very long. The whole data cannot be transmitted over a single period of transmission. In that case, the data has to be fragmented and transmitted over a few consequent frames. Okay, so in that case, this expansion or shrinking of the intermediate bits and spaces, they might happen. So how the QoS support mechanism is carried out by this MAC layer protocol? So it is said that IEEE 802.11 WLAN standard supports only best effort service. So best effort service is provided by DCF. The IEEE 802.11 task group, that is TGE, enhances the 802.11 MAC protocol so that it is able to support the multimedia application. Generally, this kind of DCF or contention-based protocol cannot support real-time voice and multimedia application. But this group, Task Group E or TGE, they are enhancing the 802.11 MAC so that they can support multimedia application. And this is about the MAC layer solution. So MAC layer solution is mainly having PCF and DCF, and DCF is actually the MAC layer solution for this ad hoc wireless network based QoS. Okay. So this was about solution in MAC layer that we are designing, PCF and DCF. What is a network layer solution for QoS? So that we have to see here. So bandwidth reservation and real-time traffic support capability of MAC can ensure reservation at the link level only. So there are reservation of bandwidth, there is reservation of the slot, there is reservation of time for one link, communication link, that only can ensure the proper QoS in network layer. So again, I'm telling you, QoS means data should reach in time, data should be unaltered, number of packets should be equal at the transmitter side and the receiver side. So all these things can be achieved if I am reserving a bandwidth. It should not happen that there is a lot of data at the sender side, and when the sender is trying to send the data, there is no bandwidth reserved to the sender. So in that case, data is there, but as there is no bandwidth, in that case transmission cannot happen. But from the beginning, if you are reserving a bandwidth for that sender to the receiver, then whenever data comes, very surely that data will be transferred from the transmitter to the receiver. So that is actually contention with reservation. So network layer support for ensuring end-to-end resource negotiation, reservation, reconfiguration is very essential for applying QoS or for originating the quality of service. Existing network layer solutions that support QoS provisioning ensures all these three. What is meant by QoS routing protocol? So QoS routing protocol search for routes with sufficient resources that satisfies QoS requirement of flow. What are the sufficient resources? First thing, bandwidth should be high for all the nodes who are in the route. Second thing, the energy in all the nodes in the route should be very high. So it should not happen that during data transmission, the battery of one node is totally drained out. So that node has received the data. Now it has to transmit the data to the next repeater node, but battery of that node suddenly has become zero. It should not happen. Okay, so QoS routing protocol search for routes with sufficient resources. That means enough amount of bandwidth and enough amount of node battery or energy to satisfy the quality of service requirement of flow. That means data should not get stuck in between. Data neither should get congested nor the link failure should happen. Available link resource info in a path is managed by resource management module. So there is a resource management module is there inside a network who is continuously checking how much is the bandwidth allocated for all the nodes, how much is the battery for all the nodes. So these things are continuously checked by a resource management module. And that is actually defining whether one path is having quality of service requirement fulfilled or not. It assists QoS routing protocol to detect QoS feasible paths that consume least resources. That means with minimum amount of energy, with minimum amount of bandwidth, maximum amount of data has to be transferred. That is ensured by this resource management module, who is checking that if such path is there, who will transmit the data from the source to the receiver with minimum amount of bandwidth, with minimum energy and with maximum data. QoS metrics are cost, delay and delay jitter. So minimum cost, that means minimum bandwidth, minimum battery, delay should be minimum and delay variation should be minimum. Okay, bandwidth is there, multiple metrics, reliability of the available link based on the link break probability. So link break probability is inversely proportional to the mobility. More is the mobility, directly proportional to the mobility. So more is the mobility, more will be the link break probability. So these metrics are very important. It can be asked as a short question. So delay jitter, battery, bandwidth and mobility and reliability of the available link. These are the quality of services that this managing unit is measuring, or resource management module is measuring. Finding optimal path with multiple constraints is a NP complete problem. So next slide, I have given you NP complete problem from Wikipedia. So this is an optimization problem. If you want, you can read it. Okay, or Wikipedia, you can get a full page on this. Okay, so how to optimize, how to find the optimal path? This is a NP complete problem. So NP complete problem itself is a very big topic of research. It will not be asked in your exams, just for your project work final year, and for your interest you can go through that. So two or more additive metrics can be taken together to find out NP complete problem. So finding the delay constraint least cost path within a network is also a NP complete problem. So NP complete problem is a method by which QoS metric is decided for network layer solution. So what are the parameters mainly that you have to remember? It is battery, it is delay, least delay jitter, bandwidth, multiple metrics, that is reliability of the link, and least link break probability. So these are the parameters which are optimized by NP complete problem. To assist QoS routing, topology information is stored at each node. This info is refreshed frequently. So as there is huge mobility in the network, after every time the resources are measured and information is updated. Okay, without refreshing, the varying network topology may become stale and imprecise. So before quite a long time, if you had some network data and that data is not updated, if you are trying to define the route, or if you are trying to offer the QoS with a long lost data, then your estimation will be wrong. So every now and then, very frequently, the overall network data has to be updated. And based on that, the route has to be defined. Then only we can provide good quality of service for the network or route determination. So this trade-off affects the performance of QSO, but every time you're trying to update the network resources or network data, it uses some power. So just to update the network power, network data, we have to waste some energy, we have to waste some bandwidth. So how much update is required? Very frequent update will lose huge amount of battery. So there is the trade-off between whether you want to update very fast or slow, because if you are updating, you are wasting some energy. So trade-off means there is a balance. Okay, this trade-off affects the performance of QoS routing protocol. For satisfying the QoS requirement, frequent path breaks in ad hoc wireless network demands very fast reconfiguration. So if there is huge mobility, in that case, very fast reconfiguration has to happen. Very fast rejoining has to happen. So the networks with huge mobility, we have to refresh the network data very fast. Nothing doing. Maybe we are not having more energy, but as huge mobility is there, network topology is changing very fast. In that kind of scenario, updating the network information very fast is a prime importance. QoS routing protocol should respond quickly in such path breaks. So there is a ticket-based routing protocol. So this is actually falling in network layer-based solution of QoS routing protocol. I told you there are 3-4 different types of protocol. So one is ticket-based routing protocol. I'm just telling you what is it. And more of the thing, you can just go through the slide and you can prepare on your own. So ticket-based routing protocol is distributed QoS routing. So this is falling in DCF kind of a thing. Okay, this protocol has following features. It can tolerate imprecise state information during QoS route compilation and exhibits good performance even when the degree of imprecision is high. So even if with the old data, even if with not very highly updated precise data, then also this type of network layer solution, that is ticket-based QoS is a network layer-based solution, it can produce a proper QoS or proper routing even if with old informations. So it probes or examines extensively for multiple paths in parallel for finding a QoS feasible path. Okay, so many parallel paths it checks continuously to find which path is best suitable for data transmission. This increases the chance of finding such a path. The number of multiple paths searched is limited by the number of tickets issued. So just after the path is searched, path is found, tickets are issued for the probe packet. So there are probe packet, that means the packets are inserted inside the path and just to find out the multiple paths from the source to the receiver. And depending on the path found, the tickets are assigned to each path. State information maintained at all intermediate nodes is used for more accurate route probing. An intelligent hop-by-hop selection mechanism is used. The optimality of the path among several feasible paths is explored. Okay, so there are maybe 5 paths found from the transmitter to the receiver. Among them, which are the best path can give quality of service, that thing is actually explored. Yesterday, we have done the same topology that from the sender to the receiver, there were 6 different paths. Which path is best for bandwidth? That was one criteria. Which path is best for least delay? That was another criteria. So depending on the criteria, each path is assigned to some kind of ticket. A primary backup based fault tolerant technique is used to reduce the service disruption using path breaks that occur quietly during ad hoc wireless network. So what is the basic idea? Basic idea is the source node issues one or more tickets and send these tickets in probe packets to search for QoS visible path. Okay, so if source node has issued 3 tickets, it means that maximum 3 paths can be probed in parallel. So sender node is trying to find how many paths are there between the sender to the receiver. In that case, that many probe packets are transmitted via the 3 paths, that many tickets are issued. The number of tickets generated is based on the precision of state information which is available at the source and the QoS measurement at the connection request. More number of tickets are issued if state information at node are imprecise. So if state information is not updated, very old state information are there, the sender node is not very sure whether the paths are existing or not. In that case, whenever the sender node is in doubt, it generates more number of tickets. That means it keeps on searching for more amount number of paths. Okay, so that is what more number of tickets are issued if state information at node are imprecise. It improves the chances of finding a more parallel feasible path from the sender to the receiver. Fewer tickets are issued if QoS requirements are not stringent and can be met easily. So very simple kind of quality of service requirement is there. In that case, less number of tickets are issued. But if it is very hard kind of real-time application that the QoS must be met, okay, QoS criteria must be satisfied. In that case, more number of tickets are generated. So for soft real-time system, fewer tickets are generated. For hard real-time system, more number of tickets are generated. And we have seen what is soft and hard real-time system last day. It reduces the level of search for a simpler soft kind of system, which in turn reduces the control overhead and saves node energy. So if less number of tickets are produced for soft real-time system, it saves node energy, node bandwidth. There exists a trade-off between the performance of QoS and the control overhead. So for hard control, hard real-time control, more QoS requirement is there, more number of tickets are produced. In that case, more power wastage, more bandwidth wastage will happen. And all these things are less for soft real-time system. At source node, state information are available for intermediate nodes. They are useful to find much better QoS path. So all the sources are knowing what are the intermediate node data. So all this data together is used for tickets-based routing. The state information at each node is about estimation of end-to-end delay. So whenever 3-4 different probe packet and 3-4 different tickets are generated, they are actually calculating how much is the end-to-end delay from the source to the receiver and available path bandwidth for every other node present in the network. So it finds two things. One is delay and another is bandwidth from the source to the destination. Two algorithms are proposed for ticket-based routing. One is delay constraint and another is bandwidth constraint. In delay constraint QoS routing, each probe accumulates a delay of the path. That means they are finding how much is the delay from sender to the receiver, and it is producing a lowest cost path with least delay. And the lowest cost path is having lowest energy. That is another thing. Okay. And the sources node issues yellow ticket and green ticket. So there are mainly two kinds of tickets which are generated. The yellow tickets are preferred paths that satisfy QoS matrix requirement of a probe. And the green tickets are used to search QoS path with low cost. So these are the questions asked very frequently. What is yellow ticket and what is green ticket? So yellow ticket is the path which satisfies all the QoS metrics requirement of the probe. That is delay constraint QoS routing. Yellow tickets are issued to search paths for least end-to-end delay. Whether the green tickets are used for such QoS path with low cost. So please prepare what is yellow ticket and what is green ticket. Yellow ticket is finding path with least delay. Green ticket are finding path with lowest cost. Lowest cost means lowest bandwidth and lowest energy usage. The concept behind two types of ticket is to use the more aggressive green tickets to find least cost feasible path and use yellow tickets as a backup of maximize the probability of finding the feasible path. So which path, which ticket is more important? Obviously green ticket is more important because green ticket is finding path with least amount of cost. That means least energy and least bandwidth. And if least energy and least bandwidth path is found, then we will check the yellow ticket. What is yellow ticket doing? It is trying to find out least delay. So importance wise, this is the first thing. We have to reduce the bandwidth, we have to reduce the energy, and then if such path is found, then we check how much is the delay in that path. So yellow ticket is for least delay and green ticket is for least cost, that is least bandwidth and least energy. So there are a few more things. That is, what is meant by path routing, what is meant by path maintenance, and what is the advantages of ticket-based routing, and what are the limitations of ticket-based routing. So all this I'm leaving up to you. So I'm declaring this ticket-based routing related thing. What all are written here except this incomplete problem. Okay. So this is actually ticket-based routing is a network layer solution. So what is ticket-based routing? You can find in this three slides which I have explained. Path routing and path maintenance. So path routing is selection of path, and path maintenance is if there is a breakage in the path, then how you are rejoining and how again you are bringing this path into routing. So this slide you can just go through. And then advantage and limitations, very categorically it is given here. So So 4 points in advantage and 4 points in limitation. Just go through and finish it off. So I'm declaring this first type of network layer based routing for QoS. There's a ticket based routing. So next day we will start with the next topics. So next topic is another type of routing which is very important, which is called as on-demand link state multipath and predictive location based QoS routing. So these two routings we will be doing tomorrow towards the QoS in ad hoc wireless network. Thank you. I stop here.